Did I turn this on? Am I on? I'm good? All right. Good morning. Hello? Hello? Can you hear me? Oh, wow. Yeah. I can hear me now. Church, we have one of the most awesome ways that we can begin a service, and that's with baptism, right? Someone coming to say they want to be a part of our fellowship, somebody coming and saying, I want everybody to know what happened to me in my life, right? So this morning, one more, there it is. This morning we have, come right over here, Mr. Grayson Hickerson. And if you served in VBS last year, here you go. This is one of our young people. Yes. Amen. Amen. We're going to stand a little close so they can see you, because I'm a hair taller than you are. Just a hair. So he came forward last year during VBS and accepted Christ into his savior, into his heart as his savior. But I don't want you to hear that from me. I want you to hear that from Mr. Grayson. So Mr. Grayson, have you accepted Jesus Christ into your heart as your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes, sir.
Wonderful, my friend. Then, young man, upon profession of your faith in obedience to our Lord's command, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Bury to the old way of life and raised to walk in newness of life. Young man, ring that bell on your way out. Awesome. Hey, church family, thank you for serving with kids. Thank you for serving in VBS. Thank you for serving in Trunk or Treat. Thank you for doing things that allow young people like this to hear and know and respond to the Word of God and make Him their Lord and Savior. Thank you.
Can y'all stand for one more song? You have it in your legs. Okay. We've done it before, but this is one of their favorites from summer camp, Honey in the Rock. Some of you all may have heard it before. It's some good stuff. Thank you, Lord, for always providing for us. Honey in the Rock, when we think we cannot find a thing. So, worship with us.
Honey in the rock, water in the stone, and I'm on the ground no matter where I go. I don't need to worry now that I know everything I need you've got. There's honey in the rock.
Praising, you keep proving I have all that I need.
ground, no matter where I go. I don't need to worry now that I know. Everything I need, you've got. It's honey in the rock, purpose in your plan, power in the blood, healing in your hands. Started flowing when you said it is done. Jesus, who you are is enough. Oh, how sweet it is to trust in you, Jesus. Oh, how sweet it is to trust in you, Jesus. Oh, how sweet it is to trust in you, Jesus.
Excellent work. Thank you. Thank you, kiddos. All right. I love me some Salem teenagers, man. Awesome. Thank you, Brother Todd. Yes, definitely. Awesome. He said, "Did I want him to come back and work next week too?" Awesome, man. I am so proud of our teenagers. I just want you to know, I've been praying for you. I knew today would be special, and I'm proud of you using your talents for the Lord on this stage for the glory of God. Start our service off with a beautiful baptism by a beautiful young man, right, Grayson? And got his family here worshiping with us today. God bless you. Thank you for coming. Thank you for being a part of our service today. We got a big day, and so it's already been a great day. We got our fall festival this afternoon. The sun is shining, baby! About that. And so we invite you back. If you're visiting with us and have children, we want you to bring them. It's from 4 o'clock to 6 o'clock this evening. Brother Todd will be telling you more about that, but we're just proud that you're here. There's honey in the rock. There's honey in the rock. That song was written about Suzanne. Did you know that? That honey likes to rock right there. So what a great, great song. Church, take your Bibles and open with me to the book of Ezekiel. The book of Ezekiel. You got Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Joel. The book of Ezekiel. Ezekiel chapter 37. Ezekiel chapter 37. I'll give you a moment to get there. In Ezekiel chapter 37, we find the very unusual and very memorable story about the Valley of Dry Bones. This past week, we had our Gibson Baptist Association annual meeting, and it was located at Sugar Creek Church in Humboldt. It was on this past Monday night, and the theme of this year's meeting was entitled this, Can These Bones Live? And it was based on this passage right here in Ezekiel chapter 37. Now, at our annual meeting, my buddy, Brother Brian Morris, the pastor of New Hope Baptist Church, preached a great message on this passage, and I was grateful for it. And so I began to look at this passage and began to study this passage. And by doing so, I believe God has given me a message today for us right here at Salem Baptist Church. So let's begin by reading this great story of the Valley of Dry Bones as it is recorded for us in Ezekiel chapter 37. All right, you ready? Let's get started with verse 1. The hand of the Lord came upon me and brought me out in the spirit of the Lord. Now, this is Ezekiel writing. This is Ezekiel telling us about a vision that he had. He says, and he set me down in the midst of the valley, and the valley was full of bones. Then God caused me to pass by them all around, and behold, there were very many bones in the open valley, and indeed, they were very dry. And God said to me, Son of man, can these bones live? So I answered, O Lord, only you know. Again, God said to me, prophesy to these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, surely I will cause breath to enter into you, and you shall live. I will put sinews on you, bring flesh upon you, cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live. Then you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I prophesied, there was a noise, suddenly a rattling. The bones came together, bone to bone. Indeed, as I looked, the sinews and the flesh came upon them, and the skin covered them over, but there was no breath in them. Also God said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath came into them, and they lived, and they stood upon their feet, an exceedingly great army. Wow, church, what a story. How many of you have ever heard this story or read this story before? How many of you out there have ever are familiar with this story? It's a remarkable, remarkable story indeed. A few weeks ago, Brother Stephen led us in a song, The Days of Elijah, if you remember. And that song references this same story right here. Now, this is not an actual event. It is a true story, but it's not an actual event. It was merely a vision that God gave Ezekiel. This army coming back to life is not a historical happening, but it's an historical vision that Ezekiel saw. Now, a vision is kind of like a dream, but yet it's more vivid than a dream. It's more memorable. It's more impactful than a dream. Now, this story, this vision that Ezekiel had is certainly unusual. It is certainly memorable. And it's a great story. And from this story, God has reminded me of something very important. And thus, I believe, given me a message today for us at Salem Baptist Church. I actually believe that this story that we just read reveals to us God's greatest miracle. What would you say is God's greatest miracle? Now, some of us would say it happened a couple of weeks ago when Tennessee beat Alabama. Amen. That was certainly a miracle. And Georgia fans are certainly saying that now, that it was a miracle that Tennessee won, right? We'll find out next week, won't we? But though that could classify as a miracle, even that's not the greatest miracle. So what is the greatest miracle? Now, as you know, when Jesus came into the world, he performed many miracles. Why did he do that? Why did Jesus perform so many miracles? He did so to prove that he really was who he said he was. His miracles give authenticity to his authority. Well, which of Jesus' miracles would you say is his greatest miracle? Let me remind you of something interesting. Did you know that there's only one miracle that Jesus performed before he died? There's only one miracle that he performed that's found in all four Gospels. Only one is recorded. Some are found in one or two or three, but there's only one miracle that Jesus performed that's found in all four Gospels. Do you know which miracle it was? The feeding of 5,000. The feeding of 5,000 is recorded in all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Now think about that for a moment. The feeding of 5,000 is recorded in all four Gospels, but the raising of Lazarus from the dead is found only recorded in John. Now, what's up with that? That's interesting, don't you think? But the good news is this. The miracle that God preserved in all four Gospels was a fish buffet. And all God's people said, I heard about a kindergarten teacher that told her class, there's no class tomorrow, I want you to bring something, some article, some object that represents the religion that you're a part of. So the next day they all did. So when class time started, little Bobby stood up first, says, hi, my name is Bobby, I'm Jewish, this is a menorah, this represents our religion. And the teacher says, excellent, Bobby, way to go, that's what I'm talking about. Then little Sally stood up, says, hi, everybody, my name is Sally, and I'm Catholic, and this is a rosary, this represents our religion. Very good, Sally, way to go. Then little Johnny stood up. Little Johnny stood up, says, hi, everybody, my name's Johnny, I'm a Baptist, and this is a box of fried chicken, and this represents our religion. And all good Baptists in the house said, amen. I find it interesting that the only miracle found in all four Gospels is a fish buffet. But all of Jesus' miracles are significant and important. God chose to preserve some of them. All the miracles that Jesus performed are not even recorded in the Bible. He did more than recorded. So God selected some to preserve, and some of those he even recorded multiple times. But the Bible is filled with many miracles that God performed, not just the ones that Jesus did personally. So of all the miracles of God found in the Bible, the Old Testament and the New Testament, which miracle would you say is the greatest? Well, Ezekiel 37 has helped me personally to answer that question. Church, I believe God's greatest miracle is a miracle that has not happened yet, but it will. And guess what? Not only is it going to happen, but all of us are going to see it happen when it happens. You see, the Bible is filled with miracles, but I believe the greatest miracle has not happened yet. But when it does, if you're born again as I'm born again, we will see it happen together. Well, then what is it? God's coming greatest miracle, I believe, is the coming resurrection of the dead in Jesus Christ. Everyone who dies in the Lord, everyone who has died in the Lord in the Old Testament and the New Testament, and including all of those of our family that have died in modern times, everyone who is saved but has died will be raised from the dead. I believe it will happen. I believe we all who are saved will see it happen. And I believe it will be God's greatest miracle. Now this morning we're going to take a look in Scripture and we're going to learn about this greatest miracle. And there's four important things we're going to learn about it. This is what we're going to learn. Corey will have these on the screen. Here's the four things we're going to learn about it. Number one, God's greatest miracle illustration. Number two, God's greatest miracle application. Number three, God's greatest miracle demonstration. And finally, number four, God's greatest miracle revelation. We begin right here in Ezekiel 37 with number one, God's greatest miracle illustration. Now, we've already read the story of God raising the dead bones back to life, but now let's read the rest of the story, all right? Let's grab verse 10 again, and then we'll read some more. The Bible says, "So I prophesied as God commanded me, and breath came into them, and they lived, and they stood upon their feet, an exceedingly great army. Then God said to me, 'Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They indeed say, our bones are dry, our hope is lost, and we ourselves are cut off. Therefore, prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, behold, all my people, I will open your graves.'" Underline that. Open your graves. "And I will cause you to come up from your graves." Underline that. Come up from your graves and bring you into the land of Israel. "Then you shall know that I am the Lord, when I have opened your graves, O my people, and brought you up from your graves. I will put my spirit in you, and you shall live, and I will place you in your own land. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken it and performed it. Thus says the Lord." Okay, church, I believe God is telling us about his coming greatest miracle, and it is the resurrection of the dead of all his people. Now let's look at it again. Look at verse 12 one more time. "Therefore prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, behold, O my people, I will open your graves and cause you to come up from your graves and bring you into the land of Israel." Once the army of dead bones came to life, God told Ezekiel to prophesy to them. That means give this army, an army of formerly dead bones, give them, this now living army, the word of God. That's what the word prophecy literally means. It is to proclaim God's word. And what was God's word that he told Ezekiel to give to them? God says, "I will open your graves and cause you to come out of them. Now, church, that's black ink on white paper, any way you look at it. This is God revealing to us, I believe, His greatest miracle. Once God raised these dead bones into a living army, He had Ezekiel to prophesy to them that one day, just as He had raised this army up, that one day God will raise up all of His children out of their graves. Now, wait a minute. How do we know God wasn't speaking allegorically here? How do we know God wasn't just speaking symbolically here? I mean, the Bible is filled with symbolism. How do we know God was not just speaking symbolically here? I mean, did God actually mean He will raise up His people literally, physically from the dead out of their graves? I mean, to quote Joe Biden, come on, man. Yes. Yes, God meant just exactly what He said. God is speaking of His coming greatest miracle right here. Yes, God is speaking allegorically. Yes, God is speaking symbolically here about the nation of Israel, as we are about to see. But God is also speaking literally. He's also speaking very physically here about all who die in the Lord, as we shall also see. God just gave us an illustration about dead bones coming back to life to Ezekiel. And God uses this as an illustration of His greatest miracle, the resurrection of all the dead. And then He told us He's going to do it again. He's going to do it again. Therefore, I believe Ezekiel's vision is an illustration of God's coming greatest miracle of the resurrection of the dead of all God's people. The Valley of Dead Bones is God's greatest miracle illustration. That brings us to number two, God's greatest miracle application. Ezekiel's vision is the illustration. So what is the correct application? Well, let's just look again at Ezekiel 37. Look at verse 11. Then he said to me, Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Okay, look at verse 12. Therefore prophesy and say to them, Thus says the Lord God, Behold, O my people, I will open your graves and cause you to come up from your graves and bring you into the land of Israel. So we see specifically that God is speaking about and referencing the nation of Israel. Ezekiel's audience, those he would be writing to anyway, was the nation of Israel. So yes, the application of this vision is that the nation of Israel would be restored from the dead, so to speak. Let me show you. Jeremiah said the same thing. Flip back just two books to Jeremiah chapter 32. Jeremiah 32. He prophesied the same thing, that Israel would be destroyed, dead and gone, and then come back into being once again. Jeremiah 32, verse 37. The Bible says this. God is speaking through Jeremiah. He says, Behold, verse 37, I will gather them out of all countries where I have driven them in my anger, in my fury, in great wrath. I will bring them back to this place. And I will cause them to dwell safely once again. They shall be my people, and I will be their God. And then I will give them one heart in one way. And they may fear me forever for the good of them and their children after them. The prophet Jeremiah prophesied the exact same thing that the prophet Ezekiel prophesied. Jeremiah prophesied that Israel would be raised up from the dead and brought back to become a nation once again. That's exactly what Ezekiel was prophesying in the Valley of Dead Bones. You remember the story. God warned His children. He warned them time and time again. He sent prophet after prophet. We've been studying the prophets in Sunday school. We've been studying about Amos and Jonah and Hosea and Micah. And prophet after prophet warned them if they don't turn from their wicked ways, God would allow an invading army to come in and destroy them. They didn't repent, and God did what He said He was going to do. And they brought an army in to destroy them, took them into captivity, captivity. The leader of the army was Nebuchadnezzar. You see, church, do you know what is true? It is this. God always keeps his promises. God always keeps his promises. He told them he would be taken into captivity if they didn't repent. They didn't repent. He raised up Nebuchadnezzar, and they were taken into captivity, just as God promised. Israel, there was no more Israel, no more nation of Israel, because they were in captivity. But God also promised through Jeremiah and through Ezekiel that even though God was going to punish them and destroy them for their rebellion, he would bring them back. He would raise them up as if from the dead to bring them back. And God did. He took them out of Babylon back to the promised land. That's why we have the books of Nehemiah and Ezra to tell us the story. Even Esther tells us the story of the restoration and the return of Israel. And you know why? Because God always keeps his promises. Just as God prophesied through Ezekiel, God raised up Israel into a nation once again. It was as if Israel died and then came back to life. But you say, wait a minute. Wasn't Israel destroyed again after Jesus lived? Wasn't Israel destroyed again after Jesus ascended back to heaven? Yes, they were. In A.D. 70, the Romans destroyed and decimated the nation of Israel. And when Rome destroyed Israel in A.D. 70, there was no longer a nation of Israel. There was no longer a homeland of the Jews. There was no temple, no animal sacrifice, no Israel, no homeland, no nothing. No nothing, that is, until about 2,000 years later. On May the 14th, 1948, God raised up a nation of dead bones. And Israel became a living, thriving nation once again. And when Israel became a nation in 1948, God took a nation that was dead, a nation of dead, dry bones, a nation that had been dead for 2,000 years, and God raised them up into a living, thriving nation. Why? Because God always keeps his promises. And he did what he said he was going to do. And that's very significant for us in this day and time that we live. Ezekiel's vision of the Valley of Dry Bones is God's greatest miracle illustration. It was an illustration of the resurrection of the dead of all of God's children. When Israel became a nation again in 1948, it was God's greatest miracle application. We could apply the miracle of Ezekiel to the restoration of Israel in 1948. But church, as I said, God prophesied that his children would rise up out of their graves in a literal resurrection of the dead. Not just a symbolic resurrection of a nation, which God did, but also a literal physical resurrection from the dead. Therefore, that brings us to number three, God's greatest miracle demonstration. Yes, God is speaking allegorically about the nation of Israel, as we saw, but God is also talking about a literal physical resurrection from the dead of all of those who die in the Lord. Now, his greatest miracle has not yet happened. It's not yet happened, but it will. Why? Because God always keeps his promises. But even though it's not happened yet, he has demonstrated it for us. He demonstrated it for us by raising his own son, Jesus Christ. Let me remind you the story. Turn with me to Luke chapter 24, the very last chapter of the book of Luke. And God demonstrated his greatest miracle. He gave us an appetizer. He gave us a movie trailer to whet our appetite of that coming greatest miracle, by raising his own son from the dead. Luke chapter 24. Now, the miracle of the resurrection is found in all four Gospels, and I like Dr. Luke's account the best. Let's read verse 1. Now, on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, this is the Sunday after the crucifixion of Jesus, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb bringing the spices which they had prepared. But they found that the stone rolled away from the tomb. It had already been moved. Then they went in and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And it happened, as they were greatly perplexed about this, that behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. These are two angels. Then as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said to them, why do you seek the living among the dead? He's not here, but is risen. That's one of my favorite lines in the Bible. Why do you seek the living among the dead? He's not here, but is risen. Remember how Jesus spoke to you when he was still in Galilee, saying the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again. And yes, they remembered his words. God sent his own Son in the world. Jesus was born as a man in the manger of Bethlehem. He lived as any normal man. He even died as a man. He died as an innocent man on a cruel cross shaped like that right there. And because he died, he was buried in a tomb. But praise God, it was just a borrowed tomb. 3 days later, Jesus Christ arose from the dead. And the resurrected Jesus appeared to over 500 people at once, verifying his resurrection. He's alive and well today. Praise God, Jesus is alive. Hallelujah and amen. Though God's coming greatest miracle of the resurrection of all God's children has not happened yet, it has, however, been demonstrated when Jesus Christ was raised from the dead. And that is why the Bible calls Jesus the first fruit of the resurrection. Corey, I have this on the screen for you, 1 Corinthians 15. But now Christ is risen from the dead, and he has become the first fruit of those who have fallen asleep. God's greatest miracle is the resurrection of the dead of all of his children. Ezekiel's valley of dry bones was an illustration of that miracle. Israel becoming a nation was the application of that miracle. And Jesus Christ arising from the dead is the demonstration of God's greatest miracle. But church, guess what? One day, God's greatest miracle is going to become a reality. And that brings us to number four, God's greatest miracle, revelation. He will reveal his greatest miracle of all time. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, grave, where is your victory? Listen to what Jesus himself said about it. John chapter 5 on the screen. Jesus says, do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all who are in their graves will hear his voice and come forth. Just like he said, Lazarus, come forth, he's going to say, my children, come forth. Those who have done good to the resurrection of life. Church, just as Jesus arose from the dead, coming out of his own grave just like that, praise God, one day we will too. And as for that coming day, and as for that greatest miracle, though we haven't experienced it yet, we will. Why? Because God always keeps his promises. Though we haven't experienced it yet, Paul describes it for us, and John saw it. So Paul describes it, and John saw it. First, let's recall Paul's description of that day. Turn with me to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. We're just working our way to Revelation, all right? 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. All the T's are together in the New Testament. Thessalonians, Timothy, Titus. 1 Thessalonians was one of the first letters that most believe that Paul wrote. So this is one of his earliest letters that he wrote. What does he write about? The resurrection of the dead. So Paul describes to us this coming greatest miracle. Let's read 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 14. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord. In other words, Paul says, I'm not making this stuff up. This comes from God's word. That we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who have died. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. That's what God said in Ezekiel chapter 37. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. It's a bad world. It's a crazy world out there. Praise God, Jesus is coming to get us. Paul gives us the details here of the greatest miracle of describing how it will happen. He says, one day, we're just going to be living our life. Everyone is just going to be going about their own business. When all of a sudden, a trumpet will sound, an angel will shout, Jesus will descend on a cloud, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Those who are alive will be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air. Church, oh church, what a day that will be. I like what an old country preacher says. He says, today I can take an airplane ride, but on that day I can take a plain air ride. Amen. Jesus himself also describes this greatest miracle. Jesus himself talks about it when he gave us the Olivet Discourse in Matthew chapter 24. Listen to what Jesus said. This is his words. He says, when that day happens, two men will be in the field. One will be taken, the other left. Two women grinding at the mill. One will be taken, the other left. All the graves will open up. Watch, therefore, for you do not know what hour your Lord is coming. Church, be ready. Be ready. You do not know when the greatest miracle of all will take place. It is the rapture of the church. It is the raising of the dead out of their graves, and you must be ready. Not only does Paul describe this great miracle, but John actually saw it. If you remember, God somehow took John to heaven, whether in a vision, whether literally, we do not know, but John saw heaven. And God showed the Apostle John future events that have not happened yet, and he wrote down what he saw. One of the things that John saw was this greatest miracle, the rapture of the church, the graves opening up. John saw it, and he wrote about it, and we can read it in Revelation chapter 14. Turn with me to Revelation 14, 14. That's an easy way to remember it. Revelation 14, 14. John saw the rapture of the church. Now, God started talking about this in Ezekiel 37. If his foretelling is not good enough for you, he took one of us to heaven and showed it happen and told him to write about it, and you can read about it. John 14, 14. Then I looked. This is John speaking. He's just writing what he saw. Then I looked, and behold, a white cloud, and on the cloud sat one like the Son of Man, having on his head a golden crown and in his hand a sharp sickle. And another angel came out of the temple crying with a loud voice, that's the shout that Paul was talking about, to him who sat on the cloud, thrust your sickle and reap, for the time has come for you to reap, for the harvest of the earth is ripe. So he who sat on the cloud thrust in his sickle on the earth, and the earth was reaped. Church, there it is. John's just describing the rapture of the church. This greatest miracle, it's not happened yet. But it will. Why? Because God always keeps his promises. Ezekiel's vision of dry bones was the illustration. Israel becoming a nation was the application. Jesus Christ arising from the dead was the demonstration. And though it's not happened yet, it will. The rapture of the church will be the final revelation of God's greatest miracle. Oh, what a day that will be. One last verse and we'll be done. I want you to turn to it. I want you to mark it. 2 Peter chapter 1. We're going to finish with this right here. You got Hebrews, James, 1st, 2nd Peter. Turn to 2 Peter, not 1 Peter, but 2 Peter chapter 1. And we're going to close this out. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19. I'm going to give you time. I want you to see it. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19. You ready? And so We have the prophetic word confirmed. That's what we've been reading, the prophetic word, which you will do well to heed as a light that shines in a dark place until that day comes and the morning star rises in your hearts. Listen, church, if you want to experience the rising up out of your grave at the rapture of the church as I do, then first of all, Jesus Christ must rise up in your heart. Before you rise out of your grave, Jesus must rise in your heart. Is Jesus risen in your heart? Have you been born again? If you haven't, you're going to be left behind. And the Bible says they will die and go to hell. And we don't want you to go to hell because we love you. God doesn't want you to go to hell because he went to great cost to pay for your sin. I don't want you to go to hell. That's why I preach to you to the truth. But when Ezekiel saw an army of dead bones get up, God was just saying, Ezekiel, this is just an illustration. One day I'm going to do it for real. Ain't no grave going to hold my down. And all God's people said, amen. Stand with me. I invite you to make a decision about that right now. If you've never given your heart to Jesus Christ, why would you leave here without knowing? Why would you leave without knowing? Just come forward. Me and you'll have a private conversation. There's many more of these baptisms that need to take place, and they're sitting in these pews right now. We want you to come forward and get your house in order before it is eternally too late. Let me pray for you. God, thank you for your word.